The other oddball things that I had to kind of do over the years were, again, I think as you get older, you get asked to do more and more about things that you know less and less about. It's a strange kind of phenomenon. One of the most embarrassing ones was this thing on so-called personalised medicine recently, which, not so recently now, which the Royal Society, for some reason, decided that they needed to investigate the whole concept of personalised medicine. And it's difficult talking to a geneticist, but again, we had a nice mixed committee with some real geneticists and some pharmacologists. But you always end up writing these things yourself, that's the trouble. And it's a fascinating problem because I remember the day that first announcement of the human genome came, was made, a few of us, I think I was only there because of my welcome input, but we'd bidden to Downing Street to for the big announcement, and we sat in we got the usual stale cup of tea, and then we sat in a room, and in walked Tony Blair with a big smile on his face, and immediately on the other end of the room, this huge television screen lit up, and there was Bill Clinton, one arm round Craig Venter, and the other arm round Francis Collins. This was the kind of symbolism of the coming together of the kind of commercial end of the genome and the kind of public end of the genome. But what followed was slightly nauseating. It was the time when the Blairs were having their last child. And so the conversation really went on how the wonders of this great news were going to prolong the life of this child of Blair's. And the assumption was, even if it was on a bad day, he'd live to 100. What this was going to do. And of course, this hit the headlines of the next morning, but there followed enormous hype. And it, to my mind, wasn't helped by some of the people who'd been involved in it. I think they didn't oversell the benefits, they oversold the timing of the benefits. It's usually that wonderful 20 years, isn't it? Yeah. Within the next 20 years. I presume that's because most of them are kind of middle-aged and they know they probably won't be around to see whether they were right or wrong. But there was a lot of hype, and it's interesting that in the 2003, wasn't it, was the 50th anniversary of the DNA. A lot of the meetings then, there was enormous hype. I was in one in Washington, and Francis, I usually get stuck on these things as the kind of miserable bugger at the end, just to be careful type of talk. But Francis Collins had the press all week, and at the end of the week, he dragged us together into his office, a few of us, and he sat down, flopped down, and he says, "God, we got to do something useful in this field." And he said, "Let's go back to sickle cell anemia and small molecules." But I think the problem was that at least my perception was that a lot of this problem was that a lot of the work had been done by extremely clever PhDs with no contact really with the realities of clinical medicine. And the medical people who were involved were very heavily driven. Again, probably the brightest of the bright. But again, probably not people who thought very deeply about the problems of common disease, really, and biological complexity.